Well,
so
providing, hang on, providing then that utility mulch has a time frame before use, then it's a great idea. So it needs, like, for example, one of the big mulching companies or tree arborists down there used to have two piles. Pile that was now for sale, and then the new pile,
and the
that
pile
they're,
that
working
they're working
on that is heating up.
Right.
So there was always multiple, and they would tell you where to go when you would go back to get. And again, it was free. All you had to do was have a truck to go in and get it, and you had to be the one to get it. They
yeah.
Go give it to
no.
Look at how the sedge came up through the piece of mulch.
Crazy.
Isn't it crazy?
That's crazy?
Yeah, but this is still easier and better than fighting with a whole entire row, a whole carpet of it. Right. So how deep should your mulch be?
2 to 3 inches.
And that's if it's fine. What about if it's thick? Pine bark mulch.
I still think it needs to be thick.
Right. It should be about 4 inches if it's pine bark mulch.
Yeah, because it's not as dense.
So how, well.
It's not as dense.
So what would be the drawback of doing it any thicker than 2 to 3 inches or 4 inches?
Well, then your water's just going to run off.
It'll suffocate the plant.
That's right.
Suffocation.
That's right. So when you have these discussions with homeowners, the best thing to say to them is not enough mulch or too much mulch is the same thing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, and I said, I never thought about that.
I'm telling
them that today on the phone.
Okay, and what about your mulching technique? What is every single extension agent's pet peeve about mulching when we look at the palms and other trees?
Away from
the base
trunk.
Of the plant.
Ah!
You gotta keep it away from the base of the plant. That is important. And why do we keep it away from the very base of the plant?
Moisture.
And what does that moisture feed?
It feeds fungus.
Yes,
and
it
rot.
Feeds fungus and different types of rot. All right.
Carolina was famous.
And
for
what's the other thing?
3 feet up the trunk.
They used to right. They used to do it at the old extension office, that volcano mound.
Ooh, up right up at the trunk, man. It looked just like he popped out of the.
It
top
was
of the
so
volcano.
Crazy. I would be looking at it like, wow, Mount Vesuvius right here, you know. But it is very, very serious. All right. What about? After you're done mulching and you go through and you pick out your weeds occasionally, is there any other maintenance that needs to be done with mulch that you can think
no.
of?
I need to rake
no.
it up, fluff
no.
it up once in a while.
Yes!
No. You can't do that though once the plant is in it because the roots are growing in it. And that was something they used to tell us. Don't rake out the mulch or ruffle it up because all your roots are now growing in that mulch as it's decomposing.
No, because that means that your plant and your mulch is too close together. So when we're out here walking on this path, we're compressing this mulch.
Yeah.
So every now and then we need to come out here and rake this because we need to decompress it. We need to fluff it back up so that the water can go back through it because the mulch will get matted.
Right, but it's not going to decompose underneath your foot?
No, no, no. The mulch will mat, so especially in your walking paths, so that you don't end up with a flooding situation when the water doesn't percolate down,
okay. You
need to rake your mulch. Now, in your beds, you don't have to worry about that so much because you are always manipulating that area. You're always managing that area. So it's always in your walking paths and other areas where
you're compressing it.
So
but
that
it's in
becomes
the flower
one
beds.
Thick
once you put
mat.
It in the flower bed, somebody asked me the other day, oh, well, don't I rake that out and put new in here?
No, you
you're
just
mending
put some
the
more
soil.
On top.
You only put it on top.
You put more on top because you're manipulating
right.
your flower beds
right.
when you do your maintenance. So you don't have that to worry about in your flower bed. But in these areas where we are walking,
this compresses.
Yeah,
yes.
we are totally
yeah. Yeah, yes. Yeah, yeah.
Right, so I deliberately made sure that we left this bed weeded, but uncovered by the mulch. Because I wanted to show how fast those weeds would come back versus, and the population of the weeds.
This is the same time?
Same time, really?
Same time.
Wow.
Good example.
Same time.
Wow. Wow.
So, and this is why when I talk about using this garden as a demonstration area, these are the things that I want us to be able to do. I want us to be able to show people, this is an untended bed. This is a bed that wasn't done with Florida-friendly landscaping techniques.
Good job.
Versus this bed, where we have some weeds coming up, right?
Yes, but far and few between.
The amount of them and the types of weeds are very, very
different.
Did you guys put paper down?
Nope. We didn't even use paper in the beds.
How many bags? Four?
There were three bags used. No, two bags used. We need more, and that would have helped suppress more of the weeds, but we used what we had that day. So
a lot of people have comments about the pine bark.
Uh-huh.
They have comments and they say, oh, isn't it the pine bark that draws the termites? Isn't it the pine bark that draws the roaches?
Right.
So these are the complaints that I get with when I suggest, because this is the cheapest way to buy mulch.
Well, right? I will tell you the answers that you can give for those things. Pine bark does not draw the ants. It does not draw the termites. It draws everything.
Yeah, because they're decomposing.
But the things that it attracts are the things that are here. So if you have a fire ant problem,
they're already here.
And you already have a native colony of ants, having a good layer of mulch might actually help you attract more of the local beneficial insects that'll help you manage the others.
Oh, good.
That's number one. Number two, people who complain about, oh, well, my house is mostly wooden, they can still use pine bark mulch, because if they're using it properly,
not up against their house,
they're supposed to not have it within 18 inches of their walls. And you know what? The termites are going to say to themselves, why should I go fight with treated wood when I can be out here doing my thing? And you can treat them in mulch better than you can treat them in your wall. But mulch does not attract termites. You already had termites, and they highlighted the issue.
Right, okay.
So they're your alarm.
Okay.
All right? Yes.
Would you care to explain why this mulch isn't red? Like,
that's a good question. So the reason why this mulch is not red is because we did not get it stained.
Died.
We did not get
the brown
them
mulch
to apply dye to it. So all of the red mulch that you see around has been dyed.
Yes.
And we're using Florida-friendly techniques, so when we decide not to use a mulch that is dyed, we're not allowing that dye to go down into our groundwater.
Yes.
We want to use the least amount of things that will contaminate the groundwater. And that's part of the reason why when we're doing this, and I'm going to encourage us to be out here and be more vigilant about pulling up the weeds.
Instead of using
so that
herbicide.
We don't have to use the herbicide wholesale.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because when that runs down, it's not cute.
Yeah.
That's contaminating our water.
And that's also causing a problem with our bees and other
pollen. It is.
Ooh,
and so we're trying very hard to use this garden in a very efficient, Florida-friendly manner. So that's the reason why we don't have red chipped mulch.
Yeah.
But what's the point of dyeing it?
People just want it for
aesthetic value. They like to look different.
And most master gardeners, when they discuss the issue of mulch, they do explain to homeowners why dyed mulch is just going to let that ink go down into the water, into the aquifer.
Plus, it's more expensive.
It is more expensive.
No, well, the red mulch is the one they've got such a large amount of now that they're running it on sale because people don't use it.
They don't.
Because now they're getting it.
They're learning. Yeah. Yes, we're getting the word out that the red dye is going down. And the other thing with the red mulch.
It's pine bark, though. It's close to a reddish color.
They don't like the way this appears. This right here is another problem. They don't want it to be this big. So these are the questions.
They don't like the look.
The look and the size. They don't want that.
This is actually really great for a path.
For out here in the path.
For the path, yes.
But I'm not going to buy 30 yards of that bag. Because that is $3 and change of that.
And the bulk is...
The bulk is
And the bulk, I got 1 yard for $26. So bulk it at least, And when we switch these out, I'm going to use all this because I want us to keep on using the smaller pieces of mulch so that the soil can continue to be built
up.
It'll
be broken down quickly.
Yeah, it'll be great
faster.
A long time.
Yeah, this takes forever to break down. And so
does I love the look
needle.
Of it.
I like the look of it. It's outdoorsy.
Yes.
Yes.
That's what I
use
in my house
natural.
Because I like.
All right. I think that is all I have for today. Do you all have any questions or?
Any old tree be used as mulch?
Yes.
Okay. So what's
any old vegetation can be used as mulch.
Does it? Can you just chop a branch off and throw it in a chipper and
yes.
mulch it?
Yes.
Or do you have to wait for a specific?
Well, you gotta wait for it.
You don't
want to
do something like your pepper trees,
right?
Because then that would just spread pepper trees everywhere.
Unless you compost it properly.
Yeah, it needs to be eaten.
Yes. So you can
you can green
compost
mulch
pepper
down.
Trees.
Yeah. You put green mulch down
like green
from the chipper. It'll take all the nitrogen out of your plants and cause your plants to go.
It will starve your plant. So make sure that your mulch has
hot.
Been composted, it's not brand new, and still hungry.
Okay,
because
so
it's gonna take
the compost pile over there, can you use that as mulch?
Yes.
Is that ready?
What is better, one of these, like the mulch, the pine chips, or the compost?
Both.
Good question.
So what you do you would turn that and make that very, very small particle. And you put that to the bottom. And then you put this on top so that what's on the bottom can provide nutrient. It can provide moisture. This is just a really nice covering. So this is like when you put the covering over the car to protect it. And that is the car itself.
The gasoline.
Yeah.
Okay, now the compost. When the compost is ready, I incorporate that in the sand.
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't top dress. It's too precious.
Well, I would till it into this bed.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
But I wouldn't till it in every year. I'd only till it in once every 3 years.
Yeah, but would you
all
top
the rest
dress?
Of the years, I would put it just as a top dressing.
Okay, then. That bed over there that you've got the begonias in, was flowered. Before you put the mulch in, would you have top dressed it with that compost?
Dang.
Okay.
Yes.
What is top dressing?
Every hole that the begonias, it's
top
when
top
you're
top.
Putting
could
it on
I
top.
Could I have done that this year then before I started the garden that I put back in again after all of those marigolds that I took out that are now completely covered with weeds?
Yes.
I should have done that
And
first.
Another thing that we did over there with the begonias was we put potting mix in with them and we broke up their roots but we put the potting mix in because the potting mix has a lot of peat moss so it would hold the moisture in because that was a day when we didn't have running water
And it has perlite in it, the potting mix.
Well, the potting mix it has the peat moss so what that does is that holds the water in there and then we put the mulch on top
to
give it an umbrella to keep the sun from baking it and sucking out the moisture as well. So, yeah. All right, so the next time that we get together, I'm going to be doing the design part of the landscape design and plant selection book.
Woo-hoo!
We're going to do the design portion because I really want you all to be able to do site visits and assist homeowners with design plans.
So this is like
and
a demonstration garden?
We're going to be
That's
using
this
for the students and for demonstrations, yes. So those beds over there are my demonstration beds. That's what I put those plants in for. That way we can show people that Florida Friendly is not ugly. It's not native only. It's low maintenance. Our next class is going to be using the Florida Friendly landscaping design portion of the book. And we're going to do three different types of designs. Two of them are going to be for HOAs. And one of them is going to be for a homeowner with no restrictions. So come bring your thinking caps, and we will get this
like
on
we
the way
in
for
the class.
Yes,
oh,
we're going to be doing it in the
fun.
Class again.
That was very good. Yeah.